The scripture for today is Psalm 128. Blessed are all who fear the Lord, who walk in obedience to Him. You will eat the fruit of your labor, blessings and prosperity will be yours. Your wife will be like a fruitful vine within your house. Your children will be like olive shoots around your table. Yes, this will be the blessing for the man who fears the Lord. May the Lord bless you from Zion. May you see the prosperity of Jerusalem all the days of your life. May you live to see your children's children. Peace be on Israel. These are the words of our Father. Amen. When God pointed me to this scripture, I couldn't understand why. I thought, why Psalm 128, Lord? You know, and then I started thinking about it a little bit more, and I think this psalm was written for believers to understand that joy can only come through God. And unfortunately, society wants to force men and women to believe that the key to our success, the key to our joy and our happiness, is through finances and fame. When actually the key to our success and our joy is our faith in Jesus Christ. Although having complete success and bringing your family up with the Lord is a couple's teamwork, definitely for a couple, but the expectations of the Bible lean towards the Father. He should be leading the family in the Word of God, in a full life of God. But please don't misunderstand me, because I truly praise families that get their children to church, that teach them about God and bring them up in the ways of the Lord, whether man or woman. But it is a man who will answer to God. Scripture tells us that. And he's going to answer to him for what all he did with his family. I know how difficult it is in this day and age to be a good woman. I can't imagine what you're going through as a man, to be a good husband, to be a good father. The concept of the perfect dad is so far out of whack in society. You watch any family sitcom and you see that it's just really bad. You figure that out pretty quickly. You can watch some of the commercials and realize what the ideal father role is to society, and it's certainly not biblical most of the time. You know, Noah clung to God in spite of the wickedness all around him. What could be more relevant to us today? He was nowhere near perfect, but he did so much for his family. God was pleased with his devotion, and he blessed and protected him and his family. God wants that for us as well. Being faithful and obedient isn't something we just do like running a quick mile. No, it's something that we have to endure for a lifetime. It's like more of a marathon, many marathons. God doesn't want our happiness to be determined by our physical or financial condition. He wants our spiritual condition to determine our happiness. And although providing for a family financially is so important, how we worship with them is even more important. Psalm 128 focuses on successful living, the pathway to fulfillment, to satisfaction, to contentment, and is detailed in those six verses. But also in those verses, we learn how we shouldn't allow our external circumstances to be what makes us the happiest. It should be our internal contentment that brings us the most joy. And what we do have to do is we have to rely on Jesus Christ to be that source of our eternal joy and everlasting happiness. Let's look at Psalm 128 just a little bit closer. Blessed are all who fear the Lord, who walk in obedience to Him. What does it mean to actually be blessed if it isn't fame and wealth like we know it to be? Well, scripturally, being blessed means being happy, being fulfilled, being satisfied through God. And praise God that Jesus made that possible for us already through his sacrifice on the cross. However, the theme of this psalm tells us that we must fear the Lord to achieve the complete blessing. We can't just talk about fearing God. We can't act like sometimes there is a God to fear and sometimes there isn't. We must always take God seriously and fear him at all times. And when we are in fear of him, we choose to walk in his ways. Walking in God's ways is just the way to live daily obedience to the word of God. Fearing the Lord is to love him with all of our heart, all of our mind, and all of our soul. You know, we have to be sincere. If our heart is full of love and obedience for the Lord, then our feet will follow. We will never be truly happy while living in disobedience to God. Only walking in God's ways will be truly satisfied and will be content. One of the greatest stories of struggle in the Bible concerns David, and he was a special favorite of God. He trusted God to help him defeat the giant Goliath and put his faith in God. And when he was running from King Saul, he didn't fear because of God. David sinned greatly, but he repented and he found forgiveness. And his son Solomon went on to become one of Israel's greatest kings. Another man's story that proves our sin has consequences and we can't hide from them, but God wants our whole heart and he will be there for us. Verse 2 states, "You will eat the fruit of your labor. Blessings and prosperity will be yours." God will give us daily bread, but it needs to be made by our own labor. And labor doesn't always mean what we think of when we hear the word. Labor can be from the sweat of the brow or the sweat of the brain. God sees no difference. Scripture is just reminding us that without God, doing any kind of labor would be in vain. Can you imagine how difficult it would have been for Moses? After all the labor he did, he was a larger-than-life character, but he was still only a man. He shows us that anyone can achieve anything, an overwhelming task no less, when they stay close to God. However, God used him to get the entire Hebrew nation safely to the Promised Land, but God did not allow him to take them into the Promised Land. Yes, with God all things are possible. However, God sometimes wants us to delegate our duties to actually get the job done. Moses taught us that everyone needs a Savior, because we're all going to make mistakes. Moses could have fought back and tried to take the people into the Promised Land himself, but he knew fighting against God would be a lost battle, because God's will for our life is always going to prevail. And if we just trust him, we will benefit from those blessings. But just as Moses, we will get the promise that our labor will be fruitful and we will reap the reward. Heaven's favor will come over us if we just walk the walk that God requires of us. Verse 3 promises us that if we do as God directs us, our home life will be blessed as well. Your wife will be like a fruitful vine within your house. Your children will be like olive shoots around your table. Although not essential crops, they were very important to ancient Israel. Vines and olive plants, they are biblical symbols of abundant life. They are not food staples like wheat and corn, but they do symbolize rich blessings. Olive plants grow very slowly, but if cultivated properly, they will actually yield fruit for up to 800 years. It will literally take time to see the fruit from our children, making them strong, stable, well-rooted, and well-grounded individuals. It's probably not going to happen overnight, but their blessings will definitely come back to us. Although fruitful vines and olive plants weren't needed for survival, they sure made their lives much better. A happy wife is an essential for survival. Oh, I don't think I can say that. We've all heard the saying, happy wife, happy life. Actually, a happy wife and flourishing children are not essential for survival, but they will greatly enrich our lives. I do believe allowing the world to conform us will be the ruin of the Christian family. Biblically, men need to be the walls for the vines of that family to cling to. The family needs something strong to lean on and to build on. They will need pruned, unfortunately, when they get unruly, but most of them will need shown how to find the light of God to help protect and give them the ability to grow in him, to grow in his way. And you're going to need to use a lot of spiritual miracle grow. Prayer to let them reach their greatest potential. And God does hold men responsible. It was Adam that was searched out, even though Eve took the first bite of the apple. And of course, Adam didn't have any example to follow being the first human father. But like us, he had God the Father to teach him. But of course, he didn't listen any better than us either. And he strayed and caused sin for all generations. So in reality, his life story teaches us that we all will face consequences. Adam taught us how there is nothing that is hidden from God, and God wants us to admit our wrongs instead of blaming others. He wants us to admit our shortcomings and our failures. Being blessed when you fear the Lord is mentioned again. It was mentioned in the beginning, and it's mentioned again. It wants to give us the assurance for all who respect and honor the Lord as they should. However, we know that even though we fear the Lord, we don't always receive the blessing the psalmist is speaking of. The possession of riches will not ensure our blessings. A healthy and beautiful family will not ensure our blessings. Our blessings come from God alone as a result of living biblical. The things listed in Scripture were more of a general description for ancient Israel, not the same for us today. Our blessings may not be achieved this side of heaven, but we still must show our Creator the respect He deserves. This was proven by Abraham as he taught Isaac an invaluable lesson on respecting God. Abraham was such an obedient man that Isaac could have gone wrong. First, Isaac's father, Abraham, led an entire nation. Can you imagine trying to be like him as a man, as a dad? I am sure he felt intimidated. He definitely could have resented his father for offering him as a sacrifice, yet Isaac stayed strong in the Lord and became one of the most favored fathers in the Bible. He knew his father made mistakes when he relied on himself instead of God, but he also learned the genuine faith pleases God, and He will still rescue and support us through all of our dumb mistakes. May the Lord bless you from Zion, verse 5 begins. May you see the prosperity of Jerusalem all the days of your life. Zion was the center of blessings, and the people looked toward it as they needed their mercy. And the psalm finishes with, "May you live to see your children's children, peace be on Israel." The ancient singer of this psalm had an idea of what it meant to be blessed personally. The blessings of those who fear the Lord go beyond the holy city and impact the holy family as well. The psalmist sees the blessing as enjoying grandchildren. He teaches us that it's not enough to see our children's children unless we have hearts to have compassion to pray for not only those in our home, but those all around us. This type of contentment isn't for those who reject Jesus, because as we know, genuine satisfaction is only found in knowing God. We know God the Father through His Son, Jesus, and the underlying theme of the Psalm 128 is that a deep-seated contentment can only be found in fearing and obeying the Lord. The key to a fulfilled life is having a right relationship with God. It is found in trusting and walking with Him. Only in fearing and following God does a person experience successful living. The most important life choice anyone will ever make is their response to this fundamental question. So choose today who you're going to follow, God or Satan, the spirit or flesh, light or darkness, life or death, fear or faith, the truth or a lie. Because the answer to this question has eternal consequences. And sometimes it's hard to trust God's plan when being obedient causes us to be humiliated and disgraced to those around us. However, like the case of Joseph, Jesus's earthly father, it created a closer relationship with God. He has to be one of the most unappreciated fathers in Scripture, I think. Yet Scripture does call Joseph a righteous man. Can you imagine the strength that Joseph had to have to keep Jesus and Mary safe by going place to place? He knew his son was the Messiah, and he did all he could to help Jesus grow up with an education, a trade, a good home. He held on to his integrity and did what he signed up to do. God respects men of integrity. Now, men, I have mentioned a few fathers of the Bible, and of course, I left the best for last. And unfortunately, his ways are probably the most unattainable, because his ways are perfect, are upright and just, and he does no wrong. And when we think about God, our Father, our provider, our protector, it puts our lives in a whole new perspective. But praise the fact that we are all children of the most amazing God, and we have a constant source of strength and wisdom and hope to share and teach everyone around us. Men, I am sure you are aware he is the best example of a father, of a man, that you could ever emulate. Dependable, faithful, and a constant source of love and understanding, with, of course, some merciful consequences. What will your kids remember most when you're gone? Will they remember what you bought them or what you taught them? I can say without contemplation that I remember more about what my dad taught me than ever what he bought me. I try not to use stories of my own whenever I give messages, but today happens to be Father's Day, and I just can't help myself. You know, my mom went to heaven when she was only 59, and I had my dad as my only parent for 20 more years. And because of this, it was during my adult years, and I had the opportunity to have a much deeper relationship with him. I can probably tell you on one hand the list of material things that he ever gave me, and it's not because he didn't give me much. It's because I remember most about what he taught me. My dad had a rough life. His mom died when he was only 6, and his father was an alcoholic. So he was left more with people that he didn't know than he ever was with his father. His dad did not give him a stable home. He didn't have a stable home. Matter of fact, many nights he was looking for a place to lay his head. You know, he watched the love of his life, my mom, die from cancer so young, and then he died of cancer himself. Yet he still taught me how I can lose, but never to quit. He taught me how to win and give the credit to the Almighty. He taught me determination. He taught me that I was definitely going to get beat up in life, but to not let it beat me down. He gave me a lesson in character and integrity that I would never find in a textbook. Dad also made me very aware of the fact that no matter how many times I fell, as long as I got up one more time than falling, I would succeed. You know, you may be sitting there today thinking, I can't be a great dad. I don't know how to be a great dad because maybe you didn't have a father to show you that. But truly, you can change that. You can't do one thing about your ancestors, but you can definitely do something about your descendants. Not alone, though, only with the help of Jesus Christ. Amen.